This is Back to Back.
Yo, what's up, Back to Backers? This is Willy Joy. Welcome to the show. This is Back to Back, episode 20. Holy shit, we made it to 20 weeks, you guys. And I know I've said this before, but I promise you, we are just getting started. My guest on the show today is Crizzly, and Crizzly just released his new Crunkstep Volume 4 mix, Flex Forever. It's up on his SoundCloud right now. The link is going to be in the description of this show. He stayed at my house for a couple nights. He was working on this mix while he was there. I got to hear it being created, and I can tell you it is crazy. It is beyond a usual DJ mix, so definitely go and check that out. Little business to cover just at the top of the show here. This week, I was a guest on the Tall Tales podcast run by my friend Them Jeans, who's an iconic staple of DJing in Los Angeles. He's run Tall Tales, his podcast, for almost 5 years now. It was a huge inspiration to me when I started my show, and I was really honored to be asked to come on there. We had an awesome, hilarious conversation. We talked about music, about life. We talked about Taco Bell. It's all over the map. It's an amazing podcast. I really suggest you go check it out. Go to talltalespodcast.com. Check out my episode. It just dropped this Monday. So how are you guys doing? Everybody good? You have a good weekend? I just got back from Palm Springs. I was out there this weekend for my friend Brill's wedding, and man, it was an incredible time. I really needed to get away, and the collection of people he and his fiance, now wife, Sarah, brought together was just incredible. So shout out to Brill's, shout out to Sarah Hudson. You guys make an amazing couple. Thank you for having me. I got to DJ a little bit. You know, there was just a great cast of characters out there. Diplo, Kill the Noise, Steve Gordon, I'm going to forget a bunch of people, Travis Piper, everybody I saw out there, Oz, man, there were so many. Basically, it was all my favorite people. When we get together, a lot of those conversations come back to artistry and inspiration and innovation, and we're all trying to push each other, and I just left feeling really inspired. Sometimes that's all it takes, just a conversation with a friend, get somebody else's perspective, get out of your own head. And I think the fact that we were all there to celebrate such an awesome, awesome occasion really just sealed the deal. I left feeling like $1 million. So let's read a listener email real quick. It's from Matt. And his question is about DJs in the industry who don't release a lot of music and don't tour that much. He says, their career is kind of fascinating to me, since some of them never really go mainstream, or they don't seem to tour or release songs that much, but they somehow still make a living making music. It'd be interesting to hear that side of the DJ world, since we all know how big-name DJs make a living by touring nonstop. I don't know if anyone else has ever brought this up to you, but I've thought about this a bunch and figured you'd be a great person to ask. And it's funny to get this email when I did, because this is actually something I've been talking about with other friends of mine a lot lately. There's so many sides to this game, and I think it's very easy to come into it as an aspiring artist, as a new artist, and to only be able to conceptualize success as becoming a giant name, like the Tiestos, Diplos, Skrillexes, Cascades of the world. But the reality is, there are very few of those people. The fact that I can even run out of names to list after just listing a few of them shows you how few there are. And the reality is that most people, even people who are successful in the music industry, will not attain those heights. And that doesn't mean you shouldn't hope for that. That doesn't mean you shouldn't dream about it. And it certainly doesn't mean you shouldn't work for it as hard as you can if that's really what you want to do. But to answer this question, there are a lot of ways to make money in the music industry that don't involve touring 365 days a year. And some of those we've covered on the podcast before. You can go back and check my interview with Diamond Pistols, for example. We talked about the ghost production that he does. Helping other people's songwriting process, production process, that can be a really big revenue stream for some people. People make music for TV or movies or commercials, music for video games. Some people teach production, either through some of the really awesome production schools that are popping up right now, or they do it on their own. Some DJs play multiple roles in the industry. I know some pretty successful DJs who sometimes, when you don't hear as much noise from them, they're producing events. So those are just a few of the different ways. There's a million more I haven't mentioned. And so if I can bundle everything I just said up into one final point, it's just that you should keep your eyes open and be open to opportunities that come your way. That doesn't mean you shouldn't pursue your goal. If your goal is to be the most famous DJ in the world, you got to do it. Go 100%, go hard on it. But just remember, all of those famous DJs have gotten some money on the side from somewhere or another. And there's no reason that you couldn't either. If you've got a question for me, a comment, guests that you'd like to see appear on the show, anything like that, you can email me at backtobackpod@gmail.com. And I might just read your email on the show. Or you can tweet at me. You can DM me, Instagram, Snapchat. Everything is just at Willy Joy. And if you like this show, don't forget to subscribe. Just hit the little subscribe button on whatever app you're using to listen. If you're listening on SoundCloud, just follow the back-to-back account. Every Tuesday, you can just open up your device and I'll already be there with a brand new back-to-back, just waiting for you to come hang out and enjoy it. All right, so let's get into today's episode with Crizzly. Crizzly and I have known each other for a long time. We're both introverts who picked an extroverted career path, and I think we just view the world and the music industry in a very similar way. Basically, I love talking to this guy, and he's a fascinating character, one of the early US dubstep figureheads, one of the first in his scene to combine electronic music with hip-hop. This was a pretty intimate conversation. Let's get into it right now. This is me and Crizzly, back to back. Let's go. You were even producing off your laptop speakers.
Yeah, and even Must Die just tweeted that like literally yesterday.
Oh, really?
It's like, up until one of his later EPs, he was using his MacBook speakers.
You know, that sounds crazy to people who, especially people who are like, oh, what speakers do I need to get? You know, mm-hmm. what are the best plugins I need to get? You know, how much money do I need to spend to get this setup? But there are people out there who make incredible music just straight off the laptop mm-hmm. speakers.
I think it's a combination of things. But if you mainly use the laptop speakers, you can get a pretty solid mix down. Because if something sounds bad, the MacBook speakers like amplify it.
Yeah.
It sounds like even shittier.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, it's one of those, this is like a tried and true thing is, you know, if it sounds good on a shitty system, right. then it's probably going to sound really good on a good system.
Yep, exactly. And it's when you're on nice speakers, everything sounds good. And that's a bad thing.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. Yeah, you definitely have to do a lot of reference. Even now that my studio's okay. It's nothing fancy, but, you know, I have nice monitors and whatever. But I'll still, you know, you got to take it out to the car. You got to play it off the laptop. Mm-hmm. You got to record it on your phone and, you know, I don't know, post it to Instagram and then delete the video.
Yeah. Yeah, you can do stuff like that. Yeah. Sometimes the Instagram compression just makes it sound way different.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that I need to be more conscious of is the SoundCloud, like how it sounds when you upload it. So,
oh yeah. Talk about that a little, because I don't even, it compresses it in a weird way, right?
Yeah, it compresses it because it makes it like a lower bit rate. What, it goes from a wave to like a 128 or even less, I think.
Yeah.
It hurts my ears. I hate it. I can't listen to SoundCloud like,
yeah.
It, with my nice speakers, I'm just like, oh, this hurts.
You're right.
I'm just audiophile like that. I notice the difference.
I mean, the way things are going, man, we may not have to listen to SoundCloud for much longer.
that's what it sounds like. But I mean, I also heard that it's not as bad as what people are saying.
Yeah. Well, they just, I think yesterday or today or something, there was some investor that put a bunch of money in. Supposedly, it's not going away now. Mm-hmm. It might change, but it's not going away, which is, I guess, what was always going to happen.
Yeah, it's weird how MySpace left Canyon left. Like, I think that was the hardest exit too.
Right.
Like, I don't remember exactly how it left.
Well, remember they had Justin Timberlake was going to save it for a minute.
Yeah.
But that was after it already. Yeah. Yeah. Like, it was
tanked.
Yeah. But. From the outside, you were like, listen, Justin, you're not going to save this.
Exactly.
Yeah. I have bad news for you, Justin.
Yeah.
My good friend, Justin
Timberlake. Bringing MySpace back.
It's weird. I've had a lot of conversations both on this show and outside of it about MySpace in like the last couple months. I feel like people are really getting nostalgic about it again.
I use MySpace to upload my random music that I made when I was like in middle school. Just for fun.
Yeah.
And like even to like show off. Like it was a little more like I have my personal page, but then it's like, hey guys, check out my music page. I just uploaded something. And it's like not everyone at school could say that.
Yeah, Back in the days before like having a music page was something actually people would get excited about rather than like everybody has one and you're like almost annoyed. It's like, go like my music page. It's like, man, not another one.
Yeah, no, but at the time it was like, oh, that's cool. He makes music. I mostly used it to connect with artists, and it was one of the first tools that like I actually got to talk to a lot of artists. Mm-hmm. And what I hit up some of my favorite producers and, you know, actually got replies back. And that's actually how I learned a lot. Yeah, just like little things like that is what MySpace like was really meant for. And I think that's same for SoundCloud, like how it got its start. People were, it was, what do you call it? Like contributors.
Yeah.
It wasn't just listeners.
Right.
Everyone on there was like a contributor.
Yeah, it was almost a community. Like when it started, it was mostly creators.
The creator, that was
Yeah.
And I think that's what MySpace was really great for. It was all just creators getting together.
Yeah.
Putting out stuff.
I wonder what
stuff.
The next platform like that is going to be. Because, I mean, even if SoundCloud doesn't go away entirely, it's never going to be what it was before. And, you know, things that are coming up after, like Spotify. I mean, Spotify is great, but it's not a community for creators. You know what I mean?
It's not. There needs to be something like that.
When you were in middle school and, like, kind of just getting into that. Well, actually, no, let's take it even further back. Where
are we going to start?
Well, let's start from the very beginning. Because are you from Texas always? Were you born in Texas?
Yeah, I was born in Harlingen, Texas. That's in the Valley.
I know where that is, actually. I think I've been there.
Yeah. I mean, it's what's crazy about the Valley is that there's probably 20 cities, and they're all, like, next to each other.
Yeah.
And they could be, like, L.A. It could just be, like, one giant
thing.
Right,
they could just call it one thing.
But it's not. It's, like 20 different separate cities. But they're all the same thing.
Yeah.
It's all just, like, the bottom of Texas.
Yeah. It's right by the border, right?
Yeah, right by the border. And that's where I was born. Only was there for a few years. Then we moved up to a little town called Bernie outside of San Antonio.
Okay.
And that's where I grew up.
What was that like, man? Was it like actual small town life? Like if you say small town Texas, you know, I'm thinking about like big open fields and cattle and...
It had a small town vibe, but it wasn't too crazy as far as that goes. Like there weren't farms or that many farms.
Yeah.
Like it was more like a chill, small city outside of San Antonio.
Right.
But I mean... It's grown so much nowadays. It's not a small town.
Okay.
That's because like it... I think so many people move there. It was named top 10 cities to live in the country for a while, like a bunch of times. Like it popped up on a lot of lists.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's a really...
So like quality of life was high.
But it's not like expensive at all. It's just good schools.
Good, clean living.
Yeah. And like my family is by no means rich. Like we are middle class.
What do your parents do?
I was raised by my grandparents.
Okay.
So that's where I was growing up with my grandparents.
Okay,
but my mom works at Walmart, still works at Walmart.
Yeah.
You know, like we're not filthy rich.
Right.
My dad is in and out of security jobs, but I mean, yeah, you know, it was just a place to grow up.
And did you say earlier you're half Mexican?
Yeah.
I don't think I knew that about you.
So I guess it was like Boombox was saying, like he's first generation.
Right.
Yeah. She illegally immigrated here.
Right.
And made a life. And yeah, she's definitely the hardest worker that I know.
That's awesome, man. Especially in this day and age. That's inspiring to hear about. You know?
Yeah, and it sucks, you know, that so many people are against like immigrants. And like she's the most honest, genuine, hardworking woman. And it just sucks that like, you know, she could have got like deported at any moment. And like her whole like life be screwed up. But at the same time, she did leave her whole life to just come here and just like make a better start for herself and for me. Like,
yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah, look at the effect on you. You know, if she hadn't done that, you know, who knows what your life would have been. Certainly
I would have been living in an even smaller town in Mexico.
Yeah.
Like she lives, or her family lives on a farm.
Okay.
And it's in the desert. And I think my grandfather grew fig trees, And it was like, we literally, the fences were made out of cactus.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was crazy.
That's pretty, have you been there?
Like, yeah, we would go every year.
Oh, wow.
24 hours just going south from Texas and just into Mexico, into the desert.
At what point did music enter the equation for you? Like when you were living in that town outside of San Antonio, were you, well, what's like the first memory you have of music really affecting you?
You want to know the first memory?
Yeah.
NSYNC.
Yeah.
That was probably it. I was on it was on Disney Channel. It was like NSYNC performs live at Disney World. And I don't know. I recorded it and would watch it like all the time.
That's awesome.
I don't know. But it's not like I got into music. I was just like, I really liked the songs. Like I like the song structure. And I was like, I would analyze it, I guess. And I didn't realize it till later on. But like,
oh, interesting.
I bought the album and like, I think it was help from my dad. Because he would buy CDs and like listen to them all the time.
Yeah.
And he was like, yeah, go buy a CD.
That's cool. Yeah, he was encouraging it. Yeah.
And like, that's what we would do. He would drive around a lot. We would drive to San Antonio. Because like, since I lived in a small town outside of San Antonio, we would have to drive there. So what to do in the car is what not better to do.
Right.
Is listen to music the whole way. So I don't know. Yeah. It was just like early on. Actually, okay, no, wait. Not NSYNC. Even before that.
Take it back.
Kindergarten. It was nap time. And we had a chance to pick the nap time song.
Oh, okay.
So this is my first DJ set.
Right, yeah.
I'm like, all right, I'm going to go in.
Play the banger.
On this, yeah. I'm about to go hard. So I pull out the cassette and I'm like, here you go, hand it over. She puts it in and it's I Believe I Can Fly.
Oh, strong choice.
Yeah.
Strong choice.
Passed the fuck out.
Yeah.
Everybody in the club passed the fuck out on their nap pads.
Yeah. On the count of three, close your eyes and lay down.
No, I went hard. Yeah. So that was my first festival.
That's tight. Yeah. Slayed it, killed it. I was similar. Like, I think the first cassette I owned, and this is dating myself a little, but the first cassette I owned was Right Said Fred, I'm Too Sexy.
Okay, that one's fire.
Yeah.
And that's like one of those songs, like you wonder like how did it influence like mainstream American culture? Yeah. That's such a weird song.
So bizarre.
But it's like a meme.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
That's
early,
like an early meme.
Very early meme. You're totally right.
Which and is tight.
That's funny to think about that like now we would say a meme, but back then you would say like one hit wonder kind of thing.
Exactly.
But it is kind of exactly the same thing. It's just like something that pops into culture for a couple months and then goes away. And
but that song lasted. Same with the Macarena. Same with like like a bunch of wedding songs that like it's just like meme culture almost.
What were your like early DJ shows?
Well, my first ones were like quinceañeras and like school dances.
How did performing or even just doing music come into your head? What was the entry point there?
What happened was I was at a quinceañera for one of my classmates. And there was a DJ that she hired. And since we're in a small town, it was just like, just some like older guy with like a little thing he rolled in with a CD player. And he just sat there and like ejected the CDs and put them in and then just like had like a little light set up. And like everyone kept asking me like, yo, do you have your CDs? Maybe you could play something. And I was like, oh, I didn't bring them, obviously. Like, why would I bring them? But like I could ask my grandma to go run back to my house and get my CDs and we could listen to them because we wanted to listen to like our music.
Right.
Like we didn't mind it, but like I was like, man, what if we could listen to like some weird stuff? And I think at that point, people knew that I had like a big taste in music.
Right.
And I was showing everyone in my class like all the music.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I had a computer and I was like downloading the music. I was the person like that shared a bunch of stuff. Dude, and got people into a lot of stuff.
I was the same way, man. I always had that like compulsion to share whatever I found. Like I would find something I really loved and it wasn't enough for me to just listen to it. I had to like tell other people about it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I think that's an early sign you may be a DJ.
Yeah, exactly. If you love sharing music, you should probably consider being a DJ.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where it started for me. Like I just loved finding new music, sharing new music. And like, honestly, the DJ at her birthday party was so bad that like I was like I got to do something. Like I got inspired.
Yeah.
I was like, oh man, I should just do it. Like I could do a way better job. And I think
how old were you?
I was 15.
Okay.
Yeah. And then I got a job at Walmart thanks to my mom. She helped me out. She put in a good word.
Yeah.
And it's a small town, so
thanks, mom.
Yeah, thank you, mom. Worked at Walmart pushing carts for a summer. Ended up saving it up and just got turntables.
What were you playing at first? Was it just all like kind of wedding jams and quinceañera jams?
I was like mashing up Sunglasses at Night with AC/DC and MIA.
Party rocking, man. I love it.
Yeah. I was doing the weird mashups, like like a lot of earlier DJs in the EDM scene were doing. Like,
well, I mean, that's how all of this started, was mashups. I was just talking to someone about that. I mean, mashups were the entry point for so many of us to get into dance music.
Yeah, it really was.
What was the first DJ gig outside of a
like,
quinceañera?
Like actual EDM?
Not necessarily EDM, but like, you know, a dance gig versus a wedding or a quinceañera.
Right, yeah. Well, San Antonio has a big rock band scene. I would even say metal, emo at the time.
Yeah.
There was a lot of goths, Hot Topic shopping stuff in schools.
And like Latino goths, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I was not a part of that. That's probably the only music I didn't listen to. I was like not trying to fuck with emo stuff.
Yeah. I kind of missed that wave too.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't hate it or anything, but
right.
I was listening to like indie more than anything. But yeah, so there was like a bunch of like established rock venues for high schoolers and kids. I linked up via MySpace with like this club owner who threw like basically like high school rock band contest,
yeah.
Like talent shows almost. That's essentially what he did and took everyone's money.
Yeah.
And
which is the way all those go.
Yeah. It was that crazy guy in town who like has a connection with the venue. And it's like, hey, kids, come play. Bring your friends. Make them pay $20.
Yeah, exactly. Sell tickets for me. Yeah.
But it was at the same venues that like LMFAO would play at, or like...
Yeah, legitimate venues.
Yeah, and it was tight. You know, like kids would be down. They're like, sure, yeah, we want to play at this venue because it's tight.
Yeah, and yeah. Like, and especially when you're young like that too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so my goal was to like bring a dance type vibe to those venues and like turn it into something else. Like, so that's the first goal I had.
Okay.
It doesn't sound too crazy now, but like back then no one listened to it.
Right.
And it was like, it basically, everyone didn't think it could happen.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
No one believed in it.
Well, yeah. Cause I mean, if you're trying to play dance music that people aren't familiar with to a rock crowd, I mean, that's even in today's day and age, that's a rough thing to do. But back then, I mean, you know, people didn't even really know what DJs were, you know?
Yeah, exactly. But I would bring my friends. So, like, right. At least I had, like, a crowd of, like, 10, which is more than what most bands would even have.
Oh, yeah.
So they were like, cool, whatever. Do it.
Yeah.
You sold tickets.
Yeah, you sold 10 tickets. You're in.
Don't care.
Yeah. Whatever.
So, like, yeah, I would have a few nights then. And then I linked up with a bunch of San Antonio's and San Antonio DJs. And like actually got into the bar scene when I was like 19.
Okay.
And I was like the kid in the clubs, and I linked up with like the hipsters in San Antonio. It was pretty strange.
Yeah.
And like,
is this like blog house era?
Yeah.
Like 2008, 2009?
Yeah. Yeah. I graduated 2009. Okay. So it was like right then, like I just linked up with some local hipster DJs. I actually met most of them at the mall.
Oh, really?
They were DJing at like Tony and Guy.
What's that?
The haircut place.
Oh, okay.
You know, the Tony and Guy, like just at a mall. It's just like a...
Okay, yeah. I mean, I don't know that one specifically. But,
yeah, it was just it's just a national haircut place.
Haircuttery.
Yeah, in the mall.
Yeah, yeah.
So he was playing... One of my friends, Josh Muscles, he went by Lit Doom back in the day. He was playing at that. And then another one was playing at Urban Outfitters. and this is how we linked up. Like,
that's so funny. There was a period of time which I had sort of forgotten about when every store had to have a DJ.
Yeah, it was like it was starting to get big. You know, there was like they were playing like indie stuff though, like MGMT, a couple Justice remixes here and there.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was like I linked up with them. Yeah, and I would just start playing bars, like actual older crowd shows, like
right.
Not my friends, like people who were like 20 somethings and.
Could you get into the bars at that point? Like, were they cool with you being underage?
Like, honestly, people loved it. I was the most honest person back then. Like, I didn't even want to drink.
Right.
I never drank until, like, I was, 20 and a half.
Yeah.
Like, barely just before I turned 21.
I didn't have a drop of alcohol until I was probably, like, 22, something like that.
Even for shows, whenever I would go to... I would travel up for shows a lot to Austin. I would sneak in just... to see the DJs
right.
and the music.
Actually, for the music.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And I would not even be thinking twice about trying to get like a beer or anything.
Right.
Yeah. That was not on my mind.
Yeah. I was the same way. I guess we were just good kids. I think my parents knew too, because they never really were that worried about me. Like I was a raver in high school, and I would be out till 8 in the morning in these crazy raves and illegal warehouses and whatever. But I think my parent, there was never any concern because they were just like, oh, he's just a nerd. He just likes the music.
I don't know what my grandparents were thinking, but they let me do whatever I wanted.
Yeah.
And honestly, I never did anything because I was such a nerd. I was a straight up band geek.
Yeah.
Through high school.
Like, were they supportive of like you trying to get into the music biz?
I mean, I took the approach of it. Like, I went to college. You know, I had a job. You know, I was like sticking to the game plan and doing that on the side. I would always do it on the side.
Right.
And then like every once in a while, I'd be like, "Oh, hey, granddad, I'm going to play a wedding, make $400 extra." And they're like, "Cool."
Yeah.
Keep
Makes sense,
up.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were never mad about it. And then, like, even early on, like, before I was DJing, they would drive me up to Austin. They actually drove me to my first DJ concert and just dropped me off.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And, like, I was there. It was when I was 16. So, obviously, I'm there 4 hours before doors right. open.
Yeah, yeah.
And, like,
so responsible.
Sitting there, like, waiting. I was so excited. It was for Justice.
And, oh,
like,
yeah.
Yeah. And I think Diplo was supposed to be there, but he couldn't make it or something. It was that first MySpace music tour.
I remember that, yeah.
DJ Medi was the first DJ that I saw.
That's huge,
so
man.
So, respect to him.
Yeah. R.I.P., man. What a legend.
Legend. Yeah. Legend. And yeah, his charisma was so awesome. I loved seeing it.
He's an incredible... I mean, yeah, he was always an incredible DJ.
It was so tight. I remember an exact moment. Like, he got up on the side of the speaker, and it was just, like, the most jammiest, vibey, like, house tune. And, like, it just had claps in it. And he got on the side of the speaker and just started, like, dancing and clapping.
Right.
And everyone was just like, man, this is a good vibe.
Yeah, dude.
And everyone just started clapping and dancing, and it was so nice. It was awesome. Yeah,
I miss that, man. I mean, that's, you know, it's such a different vibe than what you and I do now mm-hmm. with the, you know, whatever you want to call the music we do now. It's just heavier. It's a different vibe. But, you know, when I go out myself, it's more of those just like fun, like party vibes that I would want to go see. Like, I would love to just go see a chill house DJ or just a party rocking dude. I miss those vibes because back in the day, that's every show was like that, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, I mean, it was more about just like a dance concert. It was more about like people should dance. But
yeah.
At the same time, the Justice show was set up to be a show.
Oh yeah, I mean, they from the very start were rock stars, yeah. And this is what a rock star
and
looks
it,
like.
It was like it was definitely like felt like one of the first times Texas has seen something like that. And I think what he ran into was like no one was really moving.
Yeah.
Now looking back at it, he didn't hesitate at all to get up on stage, start clapping, like create the vibe.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what you're supposed to do. That's your job.
Yeah, man. I mean, it's the same with what we do. I mean, sometimes, you know, it's not the crowd's fault and it's not your fault, but you know, sometimes you're just on different energy levels or on a different page
mm-hmm. yeah.
and then you show up and you know, you have to do whatever. Yeah, get up on a speaker and start clapping or get on the mic and talk to them a little and just, you know, you got to make that connection. Mm-hmm. Be like, hey, we're all here together. Let's do this together instead of you guys just staring at me and me staring at you.
Yep. Been there.
Were you living in San Antonio or were you still in the small town at this time?
No, yeah, I stayed in San Antonio or in Bernie, but eventually I ended up moving to Austin.
Okay.
Because Austin was the place I went to for raves.
Okay.
Like, and I didn't start raving until I was out of high school.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was just hard to find shows, you know, like. Like, you grew up where...
Minneapolis is where I grew up.
Yeah, and there, yeah. I feel like there was a good scene for that.
Strong rave scene, yeah.
And there was a strong rave scene, but it took me a while to find it. And even the raves that did happen in San Antonio, there's maybe like 20 people.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's like where I first heard like Datsik songs. And me and my friends were obsessed with that. Like,
was that your introduction to dubstep? Just hearing it at a random rave?
Hearing it at a random rave at a warehouse with 20 people, weird lasers going off. Because that was what this dude did. Like... A lot of people lived in San Antonio and then raved in Austin.
Okay.
And those people who own the production, like a guy owns lasers in San Antonio. So he was like, I'm going to throw a rave in San Antonio.
Yeah.
But it's like super small and like, you know, it was wishful thinking. And we did it for, you know, the love of the music.
Of course. Yeah.
Like, and that's what it was back in the day. It was, I mean, it didn't matter how many people showed up. Like, we're doing this because we love the scene, we love the culture, and we're inviting people to like, you know, be a part of it. And that's the energy I felt when I went every time. And I love the music. It didn't matter how many people were there for me.
Right.
I was like, I don't care. Like, I'm having a good time. But yeah, we were just kids, like throwing our own raves.
That's so dope, man. I mean, that's the way it should be. I think that's the way all the coolest scenes get built is just kids doing shit with their friends and with their classmates. And kind of you just get that very organic local movement going on. And you can grow it kind of infinitely from there.
Yeah, and that was the biggest motivation that I could ever have. And like to do that nowadays, it's not as like impactful because it's like, you know, it's already big.
Right.
But like at the time, I wanted to change the world and like make a difference in my hometown. Yeah. It all comes back to just like hometown vibes.
Did you just feel like this is something more people need to know about?
Yeah. Yeah. I that's how I felt exactly. Like I wanted to like get this music across to everyone. Like I think everyone would like it. It's better than a lot of the music that they're listening to. And I think that's what it came down to. I was in class at my community college. I overheard some girls say like, oh, what's your favorite, you know, like dance song? And she's like, oh, probably Sandstorm. And I was like, I got to get out of here. Yeah. Like, this is literally like all they know.
Yeah.
Like, I need to help these people.
Yeah. It's so funny that even back then, Sandstorm was the song everyone makes fun of. Because even now, 20 years later, 10 still, years later, it's still the song.
Yeah. But it was like, it was an old track even then.
You're right.
And like, that's all they knew. And I was like, I got to show these people like better music. Yeah. Like, that's all I wanted to do. And like, it was such a fun objective to have. Like,
yeah.
My goal was to like do that. And also like kind of like beat out the rock bands. I don't know. It was kind of competition. Like,
yeah.
And like eventually I was like outselling them. And eventually I was.
And you were saying you're a competitive guy, right?
Yeah. So I was just like, let's throw the biggest party in San Antonio. And that's the ultimate goal. Like I want to throw the biggest party in San Antonio.
Yeah.
And we did it. And like we had this venue that had like an upstairs, a downstairs basement. And it was just like a full-fledged just like
jammed.
It was insane. Like it was definitely over capacity.
Yeah,
people were freaking out. Cops didn't even know what to do. They'd never seen anything like it before.
Right.
So like they didn't shut it down.
They
were just like, what's happening?
This is weird.
But like everyone was kind of stoked. Even the cops were like about it. They're like, this is cool. A lot of people are showing up.
Because
in San Antonio, downtown San Antonio, not a lot of shows happened. Not a lot of like people got together.
Right.
And did like concerts like that, unless it was like a famous act.
Oh, that's cool. So it was almost like a community building thing.
People got behind it. They're like, finally, something like
local
is happening. And that was like a big thing for me. Like oh, when I started my weekly, that was like another step in my, I had so many steps like growing
yeah,
up.
Yeah,
it
yeah.
was like, you know, like quinceañeras, weddings, blah, blah, blah. And it just kept going and going. And like, That was the next biggest step. Like I wanted to do a club, like an actual club.
Right.
And so I had this like DJ competition or like almost like a trial, kind of like a Vegas tryout.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
Like that type of thing.
See how you do.
But it was just for the local like little club
down
the street. That was actually like the closest club to my house.
Right.
But I just did a tryout for that and they liked it. Luckily the owner fucked with my music and liked it. And like I think that was the key to it. Like I had to find a club owner who he believed in me and gave me a Wednesday night, you know, random night of the week. And I kind of just blew it up from there.
Right.
And that's where I met like so many people. Like it was definitely the biggest night in San Antonio for like years.
Really?
And it was still going for like 5 years, even after I left.
Oh, after you were done with it?
Yeah, because that's all they had to hold on to.
Yeah,
like this is all we got. There's not a lot in San Antonio, which sucks.
Yeah.
But that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to change
the
scene. Like that was always my goal. And so, through a weekly, every week, jammed out at this club. And that's kind of when my career started taking off after that fact. I think that's actually how I like really started my career. It was throwing my own shows, building the scene, and like Disco Donnie and Insomniac saw that.
They took notice,
They took notice and they were starting to throw festivals in Texas. They threw EDC, Dallas, and Nocturnal Wonderland in Texas.
Yeah.
Which not a lot of Cali people know about it, but in Texas, that was a big thing.
It's a big deal.
Yeah.
Still a big deal. That's such an important thing, too, that I tell a lot of people whenever I get asked is that really, you know, people always wonder about, like, how do I get someone to book me for a show? Or
exactly. And that was the main reason why I did everything I did. It's like, I want to get booked for these shows. I'm not going to just, like, ask for it. I want to show.
Yeah, that's the thing.
Prove.
Like, show and prove. If you build your own scene, if you build, you know, a movement that other people can see, then you're not even going to have to ask them to book. They're going to approach you.
Exactly.
You know, like if you build something that's already popping, people are going to want to be a part of it. They're going to want to, you know, work with you and use the energy and the movement that you have. You can't just be an island by yourself and kind of just wait for someone to notice you and pluck you out of wherever.
Yeah, why wait when you can go out there and make a difference and like start a movement?
That's the thing. Even if it's on a small level, like everybody, you know, it all starts from a small level.
I mean, it's important to do that.
Yeah.
And if you're not thinking like that, then like that's where you should be like concentrating on. Even now, you know, I like to think of it like I have 1,000 fans. Like I need to treat them like you know, it's like a small group. Like,
right.
We're in this together. Just make it local. Make it community.
Yeah, yeah.
Community-based driven.
Each single show that we do goes into our whole career. You know, it all builds into a bigger thing. But in each one, I try to be present and be like, you know, these 600 people or these 800 people, whatever it is, like, this is, you know, this is our community for the night. Mm-hmm. So you really have to, like, reach them. And you build a bigger career off of those little building blocks. So if you're throwing on these massive parties in San Antonio, Insomniac's starting to take notice, you're getting booked for, you know, more club shows, all that. When does making music come into the picture? Were you already making music at that time?
Yeah, I was going in and out of Cool Edit Pro. At first, I was just like trying to make noises. I would record my guitar and just record my guitar. But then I was like, this needs a beat. Like, I can't just play guitar.
Right.
That's not a song.
Yeah, you can't play that in the club.
Yeah. But I wasn't trying to make club music. I was trying to play, like, just make regular band music.
Yeah.
Like, more electronic style type stuff, like chill. I had a lot of guitar pedals and I liked messing with stuff and, like, messing with sounds.
Sure.
I could do that all day. And then I didn't have the income to buy guitar pedals all the time.
That gear is expensive.
Yeah,
man.
Like, each guitar pedal was $200, and I'm just
so much money. At
I'm
that
just like
time.
A 14-year-old kid, and I already have three, and my grandparents are like, we can't get anymore. Like, you're going crazy. And so then, like, I, like, you know, use my PC more. Like, I had a PC from like an early stage in life.
Yeah.
Like, and that was so key. I would just get bored and just learn. And just teach myself everything. And so I downloaded Cool Edit Pro, made some random stuff. It was not very useful.
Yeah.
Because you couldn't make beats in it. I don't think it even had MIDI in it.
I'm trying to remember because I did use it for a minute. But
were you like recording things or how would you make noise? That was like my first thing. I was like, how do I make noise?
I think what I was just like chopping samples in it.
Yeah, yeah. And that's why I guess where a lot of things started.
Yeah.
Like you take samples because like we weren't in studios.
Right. Yeah, definitely a lot of my early production experiments were all just chopping samples from, you know, songs that already existed. And
I didn't even think there was like a beat grid on it.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Like, so what I would do was just like copy a drum loop and then copy paste, and that was my beat grid.
Right.
And like I would like attach things to it.
Yeah, you just kind of adjust it to where it sounds okay.
And, yeah.
Yeah.
And it was just like very caveman like you were saying. Just like, I don't know what I'm doing.
Right.
Still don't know what I'm doing. And that's the trick.
That's another key.
We all don't know what we're doing.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was just jamming in my bedroom producer, making edits. I guess I found Ableton, started using that. Still didn't really know how to use it for like a year or so.
Yeah.
But then I made the commitment one year to like buy it and actually make myself learn it. And then after that, I actually like made some big steps. And I think my goal at that point was like, yo, I actually want to make like electronic music.
Because
Ableton was aimed toward
toward that, yeah.
Yeah. And like, you know, I bought it at Guitar Center, but like, I was trying to make electronic music, and I think my first goal was just like, you know, like get a song on a blog, you know?
Yeah.
I think that was like everyone's first goal. Like,
yeah.
Get it out there and like you'll be known.
Well, back in the day, if you could get a song on a blog, I mean, that was a big deal.
Mm-hmm. And yeah. And I got like every song I had on every blog, and I was like, oh my God, like I did it. Like, and it was like, I was making like edits. I think my first big one was like, oh, I think I remixed a YouTube video.
Oh, okay.
Big Booty Bitches.
Oh, yeah.
It was just like some kids jamming on a keyboard and like, Big Booty Bitches.
Right.
And I was like, that'd be funny to put that in a song
and
mix it with dubstep.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Dude,
mashup
mentality.
Yeah. So I was just like remixing that, just jamming. That was like the first tune that people started playing out.
Right.
And like, I think Zed's Dead played it at my 21st birthday at a festival.
That's a big moment.
I got booked for a festival during my birthday when I was 21. And Zed's Dead played at like midnight, right when my birthday was. And I was like champagne drunk. And then they like dropped my track and I'm like freaking out on stage. And like everyone from Texas was like literally cheering me on. They're like, you did it, man.
Oh, wow.
You're here. Like Diplo is here too. And everyone's playing music. And like, we're all like, I mean, it was like a proud moment for our community. Like we made it. Like, you know, we're doing something.
Well, because you had been, it sounds like you were putting on for Texas for so long already and kind of, at least for San Antonio, kind of bringing it out of the dark ages and, you know, bringing electronic music into the light. That's got to be a cool moment to see it on a big stage on a national level like that. Mm-hmm. Especially at that on your birthday.
It's I love having the birthday on January 1st.
Oh, that's your birthday?
Yeah, cuz like I don't celebrate. I wouldn't celebrate my birthday right. either way, but like the fact that I have everybody partying on my birthday, it makes it a lot easier to plan. Like everyone's already out having fun, so.
Yeah. No, that's cool, man.
But I was like, that was one of the biggest moments. It was just like And they were playing a killer set, and I was just so happy. And I don't know. I still get that feeling, you know, anytime someone plays my tracks that I look up to. But
and dubstep was kind of just hitting the States at that point, right?
And my whole goal starting out was like, what if we infused hip-hop with this dubstep thing?
That was the other thing I wanted to ask is, when did rap and hip-hop enter the picture for you? Was that kind of just all along?
Oh, like back to mashups, like hip-hop songs, Southern style rap songs go off even at weddings, at like parties, like people everywhere, no matter like what you listen to, everyone knows that Lil Jon song.
Yeah,
like, shout out Lil Jon for like creating such an awesome movement of just crunk. And like I still look up to him to this day. He's killing it.
Oh my, he's a legend. He's so inspiring, man. I mean, if we didn't have Lil Jon, I think, and people probably look at me crazy for saying this, but if Lil Jon didn't exist, the dance scene would be so different now.
Yeah, it would be so different. And he was DJing before even there was big DJs. Like he played like EDC like in LA before it went to Vegas.
No, he's always been forward thinking, man. And people forget too that he was a DJ before he was Lil Jon the MC, the shouting guy, you know.
Crazy. Yeah. I mean, it's such a big influence.
And a producer too. I mean, his productions are a huge influence on me.
I mean, the more I think about it, the more I look up to him. It's just like crazy. But yeah, that's all it started off as. Yeah. It's just like, since everyone loves hip hop, I want people to like EDM. And I mean, I love hip hop.
Right.
Like, being from the South, it's part of our culture. It's part of everything. Like we hear it on the radio all the time. I would hear it on the radio all the time. I just wanted to put the two together and no one was doing it. And I was so surprised. I was like, why isn't more people doing this?
Right.
Like, this is perfect. Like it's like slowed down music, the dubstep, you know, mixed with like slowed down rap. Because that's what Southern rap is. It's like slowed down, chopped and screwed type stuff.
And it seemed like you were, and correct me if I'm wrong, but from an outside perspective, it seemed like you were kind of one of the first in that first wave of U.S. dubstep guys who really, you know, started getting out on the road and playing a lot of shows and you know, just being part of like when it really hit the States.
I was on the road early.
Yeah.
Like, honestly, like probably prematurely, but I think it was because I had that head start of like throwing shows and like being in the scene already.
Yeah.
It wasn't like...
So you were... They knew you already, the promoters and... Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I just got that head start just from that. But like, I still didn't know what I was doing.
Right.
Still don't know what I'm doing. But like, I was like 19 or 20, like flying to like random paint parties in Arkansas and like going to LA randomly.
What was that like at that age? I mean, I think about... I started doing that much later in life. And I think about what I was like at 19. Like, I don't think I would have even been ready to handle it just in a life sense.
I think I was ready because I was already like doing weddings and
you were
and
involved,
stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like I would literally be carrying my speakers and carrying all my lights. I had like a little light setup.
Yeah.
A little cute light setup. And I was like the...
Just like the old man you were talking about earlier.
Exactly. I was that, but at like 18.
Yeah.
And like, you know, I was used to carrying my own equipment and like hustling, but the thought of just like going to a party and playing for an hour and then like flying out, that's like, that's so much easier.
You're right.
Like,
yeah.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's what I did for a long time. And like, yeah, I was 20.
So you were already responsible basically.
Yeah. And like I said, I didn't drink or really do anything. Like,
yeah.
It was really easy. And you know, yeah, people would freak out by how young I was at the start. Cause like now you look at it and it's like, oh yeah, kids are getting into it. Cause like, you know, that's what it's kid music now almost.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
I mean, I love it still, but I mean like kids are getting into it because it's like everywhere now.
Right.
But like I was one of the only kids in my area to like be heavily into it at such a young age. And I think that's why like whenever I was 19, people still thought I was a kid, but I thought I'd been listening to this for like my whole life. So
yeah.
I'm like, cool.
When I feel like dubstep, you know, was such a new sound in the States at the time,
yeah,
and especially like your brand of it that, you know, you and maybe Dadsick and a few other people were really pushing at the time, that must have been exciting too, to like bring a whole new sound to people.
Well, I want to give a big shout out to all the DJs in Austin, because they were some of the first people to play dubstep.
Okay.
And like actually push that whole thing. Like Austin was a big dubstep driven scene.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, huge crews with like just playing dub plates the whole night. And like,
yeah.
I was we were heavily influenced by that in our rave days. Like there was like, you know, the rooms, you know, you have at raves, like the dubstep room in Austin was the main room, which is not how it was everywhere else.
Yeah, yeah.
People in Austin loved dubstep and I loved it too, but I felt like something was missing. I felt like it needed more hype, more energy.
Yeah.
It was really slow. You know, that's when everyone was still riding at 140.
Well, and to connect it back to your roots again, right?
Yeah, exactly. And that's all I wanted to do was just like, you know, make it relatable to everyone. Shout out everyone in Austin who plays dubstep, because that scene is, it's still going strong. Like,
well, and it's interesting because I feel when you first started touring, obviously there was an explosion of dubstep. Like it came in from the UK, then you and a bunch of other US people kind of took the baton and like ran with it and made it your own thing.
Right.
And then maybe a few years ago, everyone was talking about, you know, oh, dubstep is dead or whatever. Like it kind of like when maybe went back underground or maybe just another sound got hot and people love to say that things are dead or gone. Yeah. You know, it's the same way people are now saying like, oh, EDM is dead or, you know, whatever
it is. Yeah, it's easy to say.
Yeah, yeah. And now in 2017, I feel like dubstep just sort of slowly made its way back. And I mean, it's huge again. And I guess it was always huge. It didn't ever really go away. But in your experience, is it bigger now for you, or did it just kind of always seem constant to you as far as the attention and the love it was getting?
It's been pretty constant. There's definitely been a little bit of lulls, and I think it was only because people weren't pushing the sound.
Yeah.
And like, same for me, like there was never a lull in my sound when I first started because it was so new and fresh. But that, I think that's why dubstep has lasted, because it's about new sounds.
Yeah, it keeps evolving.
It's about like the new thing, and like you can add anything to the beat, you know. It's just a beat. Like it's just, that's what makes dubstep. It has like that slow or halftime
rhythmic back, super simple backdrop.
You can do anything with it, but that's why it's lasted. It's because it's a culture community based around like making new sounds. Like that's what makes dubstep.
Right.
It's like new sounds.
That's part of the culture. That's a cool way to think about it. Because you think about, you know, other genres that didn't fare as well, like big room house or something like that, where, you know, when it started, it was super excited and never heard anything like it. And then 2 years later, it sounded exactly the same and no one was really pushing it. And people were kind of like, yeah, it's boring now. We know what this is.
But the reason dubstep would be making a comeback now is because now it's taking it back to the roots of like rhythm and that's like type of dubstep that I kind of like too. It's like where it's like almost repetitive, but I like it repetitive.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna lie. Like I like it where you get in a groove. It's like a beat. Like, I just like jamming at beats. Like I like dancing, and that's what it's about. It's about moving. I mean, even if you're just headbanging, that's still moving.
Yeah.
But like it's about the energy and the flow of that. Like
and
like for a while, the reason I feel like it might have had a little lull in dubstep was because it was all starting to sound the same and all too much. It wasn't dance music. It was just noise.
Yeah, it was about, you know, just how hard or screeching or whatever can you make it, and not really focusing on what will people actually do when they hear this in a club.
Yeah, and you can hate on rhythm, but like the nature of that is just like rhythm. Like it has rhythm. And so like, perfect. You can dance to it.
Yeah. And I like what you said too about, you know, it being repetitive and that being like a good quality about it. Cause to me that's, and some listeners are going to get really mad at me for saying this, but it's like techno too. That's why I love techno. Is the same reason I love dubstep in a way, is that it's this repetition, and you know, then the small changes in it over time become like big changes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you know, if you're listening to the same loop for 2 minutes and then all of a sudden like a hi-hat comes in, that can be a crazy moment, you know?
Well, you don't want to throw too much at the audience and you don't want to overwhelm them. And at the same time, even rhythm does have some crazy sounds here and there, and like, It like now the way DJ sets have evolved, like you're switching tracks every 16 bars.
Right.
Like, so it's moving fast still, and it's ever changing in a set. But yeah, I mean, I think the repetitiveness comes from just creating a good dance vibe and making sure people are dancing and not just like sitting there with their hands on their chin, like dissecting the song,
right?
Like, listening to
just like waiting for the next drop, right? Because a lot of time, I mean, that's a problem I think anyone doing bass music is running into right now. Is, you know, just what you said. We're switching songs every 16 bars. It's like track after track after track, and I think people just get conditioned to like, you know, they jump around for the drop for 5 seconds and then they just kind of wait for the next one, you know?
And there was a moment in my career where I noticed that and I got really bummed out. I think it was at Ultra 1 year, and I just went there and like everyone was everyone had that type of set, and the whole audience was just like dancing for the first like 5 seconds of the drop, 10 seconds of the drop, yeah. and then not dancing. And I was like, man, this kind of bums me out. Like, people aren't just dancing. Like,
right.
enjoy it. Like, move around. Like, if I ever go out, which is very rare, I make it a point to like dance, like, yeah. and like actually move.
And did your production? I feel like it sort of followed that same arc we were talking about of dubstep, where like you came out with like a whole bunch of songs right at the beginning, mm-hmm. and that's kind of what launched you into the touring realm, and you were going all around. And probably as a result of being way busier and traveling a lot, it seemed like the output went down a little bit, mm-hmm. and now you're bringing it way back up again. Because I feel the last couple songs you've released have all been like one after the other, and they're all really good yeah. and new sounding. And
I've had a good break, and it's really hard producing on the road. I got used to it. I was able to do it, but I was also like losing the energy
yeah.
that I had like touring so much. And I have been touring for a while. Like,
yeah, I don't want to like gloss over that because you're such a road warrior. I mean, we could talk for hours about all the different crazy tours and stories and shows.
Yeah, we could talk for hours. There's so much like it. Yeah, that's what I was saying. Like, it's hard to remember sometimes. Like,
yeah.
we randomly remember parts of our lives that are like, wait, that happened.
yeah.
That's where I'm at now.
Like, yeah.
there's so many tours that I've been on and so many stops. And like, I'm so thankful. And like, honestly, I didn't have like a whole lot of break time until like the last year.
Do you still enjoy tour life?
Yeah, I love it. I mean,
is that like, cause for me, everything I do is hoping that I get to go back out on the road. Cause
exactly.
being on the road is my favorite thing.
And it is my favorite thing up until a point. But that's how tours work. They,
yeah,
your agent puts you out there for, you know, a few months and then you're back. And you know, you're thankful to be home. But
yeah.
then once you're home, you're like, all right, I got to get out of here.
Right.
But I mean, I think I've been doing it for so long now that like I had a good break now where it's like, I love being home.
Yeah.
I love it.
So you're back in the studio a little heavier now. Is that like a goal to try to make a bunch of
oh, yeah.
new music right now?
Right now, my goal is just to get the mindset that like, to get back to like, all right, I want to create something new. It's really hard nowadays because like I said, at the time, it was such a movement. It was like, it was bigger than like
yeah than just like an artist's brand or a single person. I mean, you were kind of like helping carry the flag for this sound and this new genre, like new to the States
yeah.
genre.
And there's no other better feeling than that, like
yeah.
than having that new sound and like yo, this could change the world. And that's
right.
honestly what I thought like when I was starting out. I was like, I could change the world with this. This is tight. And it's a lot harder nowadays because everyone plays hip-hop. Everyone plays trap.
Right.
Everyone plays dubstep now.
Harder to stand out, yeah.
And everyone's playing harder music.
yeah,
and
yeah.
it's like, it's just insane. It's like, I had to like slow down for a little bit. Like,
right.
wow, like this is
when you
overwhelming.
Have to, yeah, it's overwhelming. And I think you, at least for me, you have to take a step back and be like, sometimes it's easy to forget like what makes you different and why you stood out in the first place, you
mm-hmm.
know, when everybody else starts doing the stuff that you've kind of been doing,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is not, I don't mean to say that in an arrogant way, but it's
yeah,
just,
exactly. It's exactly what I want to say. Like, I'm not trying to be arrogant
right.
by any means. Like, I think people are doing it now because it was such a good idea at the time.
Right.
Like, why aren't we all playing hip hop in
yeah.
a sense? Like, I was the only person at EDM shows, concerts, everyone was playing like house or like big room house
yeah.
stuff. And I'm like, yo, I got hip hop.
Right.
And like, that's how I like really blew up was from EDC. Like, you were walking around EDC, hearing all the electronic music. No one knew any of the songs. Everyone was just having a good time. It was a party.
Right.
And then like, you stop by the bass pod and all of a sudden you hear like Lil Jon and like Hard in the Paint and all these like hip hop songs.
Yeah.
And like, people like gravitated. Like, and you know, now I kind of lost something because everyone's doing that now, and it's not their fault. It's
right.
a great idea.
Right.
Like
yeah.
it's fun. I love hearing it. Like,
yeah, yeah.
When I watch my friends play and they drop hip hop, I'm like, I'm going in.
Right.
Like,
but
I have so much fun.
You know, I think as and I'm saying this about you. I'm not saying you're saying this about yourself, but as an innovator, as someone who kind of had that original idea back in the day, I think that's in us. To be like, once, you know, once that idea has kind of reached the mainstream, like you said, you wanted to change the world with it and you at least, you know, brought it to a bigger stage, right? And then once it's there, it's kind of like, okay, well, what's next? What else can I bring? You know, how else can I kind of keep pushing this forward?
Mm-hmm.
It's just what you said about dubstep too. It's like, you know, it can't stay the same. You have to kind of figure out what the next move or the next wave for it is and for yourself and your career.
Honestly, for me, personal pleasure would be to just put out more of the same thing. And like at the beginning, that's what you try not to do when you're a producer and like you're just making music for fun.
Yeah.
But I guess I lost track of the idea that I have a brand now and like I have this style of music that I could be making. But I mean, I didn't want to at first. It was like a turnoff.
Right.
I don't want to make the same songs.
You don't want to get pigeonholed.
Yeah. And I never really have been. I've been very thankful. Like I've made weird tracks that are still like my style, but like different. Like, but yeah, I don't want to get pigeonholed. But I'm taking a step back and I'm like, why not? Like, why not just make more of the same shit?
Like, yeah. Well, you got to make what you like, right? Like what you have fun making.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And like, I mean, that's what comes easiest, you know, like, the music that I was making. So like, you know, my personal goal right now is just to make more.
Yeah.
Like make more of it.
Well, and you can tell too. I mean, I wouldn't say it's the same because I think you can tell, you know, obviously as we all do, you've gotten better as a producer over the years.
Yeah.
And I mean, the new stuff to me, it sounds super fresh and like, I don't know, it doesn't sound like anybody else's stuff, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, I feel like it does, you know, like compared to like I was saying, like starting off.
Like, well, sure. I mean, it's not like a new genre.
Yeah, exactly. But that's what I was doing back then.
Okay.
And like, it's hard to chase that feeling again. But I'm, you know, trying to teach myself like, yo, it's okay. Like, just make music for fun. Like,
right.
Just make something.
Right.
You know? Like, and I would be, that's why I don't put out that many tracks because like, I don't feel good putting out tracks that have already been done before.
Yeah.
Like, it's hard to make myself do that. But I should be doing that. And I think I heard it in one of your other podcasts. It's like, yo, like, rinse it, you know, like I think was it Josh or no, I forgot, they were just like, make more of the same shit, like
right.
Why not, like
right,
fucking go in
and have fun with it. I mean,
yeah,
and that
have fun with it.
Like that links to one of the last things I wanted to talk about too is like how we deal with the anxiety that we put on ourselves and the stress of kind of, you know, now that we're at this point. You're saying, you know, you felt that pressure that you were kind of just putting on yourself of like, I have to invent something again. You know, it's like, I already did all this stuff, but now I'm to this point. And you were saying you've been feeling more of that lately?
Yeah, I don't know. Randomly, it's just more coming in. But I've always had it in the back of my mind and just, you know, rolled with it. Like, it's just part of life. Like, you can freak out. I would always freak out before my sets, my EDC sets.
When I think it's probably, you know, you were saying you've been on the road for so long doing so many shows, and then, like, this year you took a little more time to be at home and work on music and whatever. And I think it's when you're at home and it's quiet and it's calm. In a weird way, that's almost when, like, the anxiety and the stress can kind of sneak in.
Yeah, I think that's what's happening. Yeah. But like,
because when you're on tour, it's like everything's a mile a minute and you don't really have that much time to be stressed out or to do anything.
Yeah, and what I loved about the road mentality is that a body in motion stays in motion and a body at rest stays at rest.
Yeah.
So, like, you got to keep moving. You got to keep it going. And that's what I'm trying to do. And you could totally do that by being home. You could just make music all day.
Oh, yeah.
And just keep inventing stuff. Yeah, it gets in your head and then it is like stressful doing it. I'd say the most stressful thing though is being a promoter. That was probably the most stressful thing.
Yeah, I can't even. I gave so much respect to all the good promoters out there because, man, I was such a shitty promoter when I was throwing parties in Chicago. I wouldn't make much money almost ever. Some of the parties were awesome. I mean, I threw a monthly in Chicago for 3 or 4 years.
Nice. What was that called?
It was called Fly By Night.
Nice.
It was cool. It was like in the early days. I mean, the same era you were talking about when you were throwing in San Antonio. And I'd bring in like a guest each month. And that was how I networked originally and like met a lot of other DJs was, you know, I'd be the first person to bring them to Chicago ever. And then they'd book me for their party in wherever city they were at. And it's kind of how it worked.
I think
that's
how I got a good hold in my agency. It was like, they're like, oh, you're a DJ and you produce and you're throwing a show. Let's bring some people through.
Right.
And we'll bring you to some other places. It was like a trade. But that's how, I approached it. I wanted to give back to the community before I asked for something.
Yeah. Like, you always got to show up to the table with something, man.
Yeah.
Nobody wants you to just show up and demand things from them.
Yeah. So my career has been way easy just based off of that philosophy. But yeah, to keep it moving, like I started a new weekly in Austin, the same name that I had in San Antonio. I just like brought
the
Austin.
Lifted Night.
Lifted Night. Yeah. So that was fun. That's like how I kept it going.
Yeah, man. I mean, and you brought me out to play one of those and we talked about this earlier today, but I still think about that day, man. And it was just such a cool vibe because we had known each other for years before that. But when I came out, you brought me out to play that night. It was Tuesday night, right? Yeah, Tuesday night in Austin. small bar, held, what, 150, 200 people?
Yeah, something if that. Like,
yeah.
Super small.
And just seeing you in Austin throwing that night with all of your friends helping you throw it, that clearly, you know, these are people you've been working with for years and years and years. It helped me understand, like, you and where you came from and kind of just why your whole movement, I think, has been so successful. So I was like, oh, this is how he built it. It's like, even at this stage in your career, you're still flying me out on a Tuesday to come play to 100 people.
Yeah, that's what's crazy. Like, people don't even really know about it. And, like, not a lot of people, but, like, I don't care. Like, I was bringing, just random people, my friends out on a Tuesday at, like, the peak of my career.
Right.
My management was not about it.
Yeah, I'm sure they were super bummed about that.
Yeah, they were super bummed about it, but they're like, all right, you know, like, like I said, I had to find that new thing to, like, re-motivate me. Like,
right.
To find, like, you know, passion, or bring the passion back to it. And that's what really motivates me, is, like, throwing a cool-ass party and, like, keeping it local. Like, I just love keeping it local in Texas.
Yeah.
Since I was born and raised there, it's just like I have to give back.
Yeah.
And I think
the fact that you stayed in Texas the whole time too is really meaningful.
A lot of people get surprised by that. They're like, oh, you live in LA? And I was like, no, I live in Texas. Yeah. Still. Like,
yeah, still.
Yeah, I don't know. I never had to make the move, thankfully. And of course you could make the move and, like, help your career out. I mean, I think about it sometimes. I'm like, man, I should have gone to LA. But at the same time, like, Texas is home.
Yeah,
love,
man.
It's,
you got to do what makes you happy and what makes you most comfortable. And I think the fact that you are the guy who stayed in Texas, whereas, you know, 99 other people might have gone to LA, that's what, I think that's part of your success. And I think that's part of what makes you stand out, is you kind of planted that flag. And in the same way that you incorporate those influences in your music and you put on for the local scene, it all goes into just kind of the authentic artist that you present as, and I think
yeah,
you
because
are.
Like, as a DJ, we could live anywhere.
Right.
As long as there's an airport nearby.
Yep.
It doesn't matter where we live.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's funny, man, because I've lived in a bunch of different cities and people don't really know because I don't put it out there. But yeah, it's like, it doesn't really matter. Sometimes you can feel isolated, like we were talking about earlier at the start of this podcast. You know, it's like, you can feel that way, but the reality is you can make music anywhere and you can send it to anyone on the internet.
The bad part about it, though, is that, like, you can get isolated and LA has such good connections that you can make, and not connections to help you get bigger, but connections just to make more art.
Yeah.
And like collaborate.
And collaborate. That's the one thing.
The reason I did move to LA is because I was on the road so much, I wouldn't have been in LA.
Right.
Which
it almost
would
didn't
suck
matter.
To pay rent for something that you're never at.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
do you think you would ever move, or are you going to stay in Texas?
I mean, like I said, I love San Diego, where we're at right now.
Yeah, yeah. It's beautiful out here,
so
man.
Nice. But super chill. But no, I could see myself living in LA. Maybe Denver, because the airport's so nice. I'm always flying through there.
Yeah.
Chicago's tight, too.
I miss Chicago, man. I could see myself moving back there.
But at the same time, it's like, I'm there, like, 4 times a year.
Right.
I'm in every city 4 times a year.
Right.
I made it a point this weekend, like, how we're just hanging out now. Like, I've made it a point recently, like, I don't normally do this, like, stay for more than a day in any city. People are always like, oh, how long are you staying in town? I'm like, I'm gone in
couple
6 hours.
More hours. Yeah.
Like, it's never long.
I'm the same way. Yeah.
Yeah. And like, I just took a step back recently and it's like, you know what? I'm an adult now. I'm like a slow learner. I don't know, or like a slow processor.
Yeah,
like
I'm the same way.
I have to do things like hundreds of times before I feel comfortable. And like, I've toured like not even hundreds, like thousands of times.
Yeah.
And like, I'm just now getting comfortable like at airports and like doing, just like getting a rental car.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Like
turning
hotel.
It into a routine. Yeah.
Yeah. And like, how I just asked you to like crash on your couch. It's like, I don't care where I sleep. I'm just going to sleep.
Yeah, man.
Chill and like.
No, and I was happy you did, because it's so rare that we, as DJs and musicians, even get to hang out with each other outside of a club.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, it is so rare, and it's like, I took a step back recently and was like, yeah, I need to cherish these moments of like connecting, collaborating.
Yeah,
and I feel like we did it, like a lot more people did it back in the day, a little bit more.
Yeah,
Yeah. Now we're all kind of isolated.
That's definitely part of it, man. I think as you get older, especially doing what we do now, the pace of life can be so fast. And when you're, 19 years old, you want life to be that pace. You want it to be so crazy.
I didn't.
Oh, really?
I was not about crazy life. That's also why I didn't move to LA. I can't handle this. I'm a small town.
Yeah. Well, and that's, we've talked about that before. I think we have a similar temperament where it's just like we're both pretty low-key, chill dudes. And and maybe we should get into that real quick before we wrap it up, is talking about the way you kind of have to interact with the public doing what we do, but then having the kind of personality that we have. It can just be a little awkward sometimes of, like we're low-key dudes. We're not giant party monsters.
Yeah, I'm not an extrovert at all. Yeah, I'm an introvert.
Yeah, and we're solo 100%. Acts, so we tour by ourselves. You go to a new city or even a city you've been to before, but you're with people you don't know. Mm-hmm. And it can be weird, man. It's like what I was telling you at lunch. Like, I'll just be sitting by myself in the green room and not bummed out, not feeling weird, but just being what to me is like my normal self.
Yeah.
And then I'll see other people being like, oh, why is it being so weird just sitting there?
I get that all the time.
Yeah.
No, I'm used to it. I don't know. It's tough, man, being an introvert and an extrovert lifestyle.
Yeah.
And it's super stressful. And that's like why I had to stay home in Texas too. It's like I need that comfort of just like having a nice house that's like not like an apartment,
right?
Or connected to something, or like crazy traffic. I mean, there's crazy traffic in Austin. Not gonna lie about that.
Yeah,
but it's not LA.
And it's just dealing too with the expectations the public puts on you as an artist, and what we were talking about before, even last night at your show, mm-hmm. where there are people who want to interact with you, but they don't even necessarily know why they want to interact with you. They just they like what you do. And so that you're there. And
understandable.
So so, they have to, they feel like they have to just have an interaction, even though
and
there's kind of no reason for it.
Yeah. And like what you're saying, sometimes it's not the greatest idea to meet, someone you look up to.
Yeah. It's almost never a good idea.
Yeah. Pretty much never. Yeah. But, I try not to disappoint people. I try so hard. And it really bums me out when, people get a bad taste in their mouth from an interaction we had.
Right.
And it's not because I'm trying to like offend anyone or do anything. It's just because like people think I'm like crazy party goer, like I'm turning up, and like I can be here and there, but I mean, most of the time I'm just quiet. I like listening, and it's hard to have a conversation with me if like I'm like doing 100 different things a day and like answering emails all the time, like checking my texts, like answering stuff, getting back to people. I'm thinking about my set like all the time, and like people will go up to me like yo, and I'll be like hey. And then, like, that's all I say. And they're like, what the fuck?
What's his problem?
Yeah. It's like, man, like, I don't want to bum people out.
You don't want to make people feel awkward either. And I think that's part of it. It's what we were saying before about how sometimes you and the crowd are on different levels and you kind of have to figure out a way to, like, build a bridge and meet them in the middle or get them to come to you. But it's the same interacting with, with just anyone who likes what we do or knows who we are, where a lot of the times they'll be there ready to party,
mm-hmm.
Maybe they've had some drinks, maybe they're on something.
And I've been flying 14 hours and I haven't eaten or slept.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to keep up with them.
Yeah, 100%. And then, they, I think, feel awkward if they come up and they're just partying, they're ready, they're like, hey, we're going to party with you. And you're just like, ah, cool.
I love talking to the fans. I love interacting with them, but like sometimes it can be overwhelming.
Yeah.
Most of the time it's overwhelming, especially for me, because I'm not good at handling it sometimes, the stress.
Right.
Like I have to be alone and like just be in my laptop and like work when I get stressed out. That's how I like manage. But
well, and for me, it's, and this is like getting kind of philosophical about it, but for me, it's like this sounds so corny, but like my favorite kind of conversation to have with fans is like when I'm DJing. Like I really do look at that as like having a conversation with the people in front of you. But it's instead of me having to talk awkwardly and feel weird about, whoever I'm talking to, I can just be like, it's what we were talking about before. Like, we found this awesome music and we want to share it. And that's, I love making connections with people that way. That's when I feel most comfortable, know? And if I can do that, that to me is like, that's the best interaction we could possibly have. That's going to be way better than you talking to me and me saying some weird, awkward thing.
Yeah, exactly. Very, very, very true. But I want to give a shout out to people who can handle it and do it every night.
Oh,
like,
man.
Awesomely. Like,
I'm so jealous of those
people. I'm so jealous. Like, I wish I could do that. Like, I wish I could walk away from every conversation and know I made like the most positive impact possible instead of just like, eh.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and those people, I mean, those people are really important. Like I've had a few people in my life who are that social butterfly, just that charismatic person that everyone wants to be around all the time. They walk into a room and just light up the room. And if I didn't have those people with me, kind of rolling with me when my career had just started out, mm-hmm. like they just opened so many doors for me, greased the wheels socially, because I could go with them and we could hang out together with people that it would be helpful for me to know or network.
Yeah, they can introduce
and,
you to people.
Yeah, and like not even introduce, but just like we all hang out together. And because the person who's really good at being a social person is there, yeah. everyone has a good time.
Everyone has a good time. Yeah. It changes the whole vibe. And yeah. like, I mean, that's crazy too. Like, I would love to be that,
right.
but I can't sometimes.
It's, yeah, and it's sometimes. Sometimes I can. Sometimes I can turn it on and have a good time with strangers.
And then the next night, like, why isn't it the same?
Yeah, yeah, you try to do it again and
yeah,
it's just like,
yeah. It's a horrible mess. and you're just awkward and you're just like, I'm going back to just being
by myself. Back to what I know.
Yeah. It sucks, you know, but I want to make everyone happy. That's always my goal. Yeah, I had a really good time doing it on Warped Tour. That was a fun time. Literally after every set would do a meet and greet, and it was nice because the kids there were so young that they weren't at that phase where they expected anything.
Did they even like know, were they dance music fans? Because it, you know, you were like one of the few DJs on Warped Tour, right?
Right,
it was,
yeah,
like all bands.
There was a Spotify stage and okay. a Beatport stage the second year that I played it, but it was mostly, yeah, just mostly bands, few DJs here and there, and they weren't so into dance music, but I was a good introduction to for them.
Sure, yeah, because you were doing the hip hop influences, and,
mm-hmm, which is what I love to do. So, yeah, I just love introducing people to dance music, dance culture.
The Warped Tour is probably the best example of doing that because those kids, I doubt most of them showed up even expecting to hear a DJ, right? Mm-hmm. And Warped Tour has that thing where everybody plays at different times, and it's
yeah.
which I like. I mean, it kind of evens the playing field where they don't release the set times till like the morning of the show, right?
It's like a social experiment.
Yeah.
It's so crazy, but it was so much fun.
Yeah, I just like that they did something that weird on such a big level like mm-hmm. that. That's really cool.
Yeah, it's crazy to say that even like I was one of the only DJs who did it.
Yeah, man. The year after you did it, or so after the second time you did it, I was talking to them about doing it.
Mm-hmm. I think they canned it. Yeah.
Yeah, I think they just canned the whole thing. I was super bummed because I talked to you and I talked to Anti-Serum about doing it, mm-hmm. and like I was like, oh, this sounds so fun. I got really
crazy.
Stoked, and then yeah. it just kind of fell apart. Well, how do you feel, man? I feel like we covered a lot of stuff here.
Yeah, there's so much. We could talk forever.
I wanted to talk about like your early days because the last time I saw you, you were talking to me about your youth work and like the relief work you
yeah.
did and shit.
Yeah.
I wanted to cover that, but I feel like that's too far.
That's just life stuff, yeah. But that's crazy. That's what I love about the podcast. Like you delve into like that part of their lives. Like,
yeah.
It's crazy. We were all humans, all kids.
Right, yeah.
And
we
somehow
all,
we hit music.
Yeah, something connected in us that I think it's like a brain chemistry thing, honestly. I think it must be something in our brains that isn't in everybody's brains.
Yeah.
Just, you know, some chemical that we have more of or less of, or mm-hmm. I don't know. They'll probably figure it out 100 years
from now.
For me,
it's a lot of entrepreneurship.
Sure, yeah. And competition too,
yeah.
right?
Yeah, and competitiveness.
Yeah.
Very much, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm very proud of the fact that, you know, I'm able to do this for a job and that, you know, so few of us, percentage-wise, I mean, it's so few people can make a living doing what we do.
Yeah, it's crazy to think about, like, yeah. we made it. We actually made it.
Yeah, man, I mean, I'm proud of us, for real. Like, it's, I we're lucky, too, but, you
super
know.
Super lucky.
But also, we had to work really fucking hard to do it.
Very true.
Oh, here's a question. Actually, two questions. First of all, do you, because I try to ask this every time, and I can't really remember for us. Do you remember how we met, the first time we met?
I was actually going to ask you that because I don't remember.
Fuck, dude, I don't even remember either.
What and the hell?
Usually I'm pretty good at this.
Parts of our lives are just
dude,
forgotten. It sucks.
For our listeners, we've been hanging out all day and we've been talking about how our memory is getting worse and worse. And this is another sign that I'm just losing
yeah,
large
pieces of
memory.
Yeah, but we definitely didn't grow up in the same area.
No, and
but how did we just
some people
know?
Like some people I talked to online a lot before mm-hmm, I met them, but
same.
I feel like that wasn't us either. We didn't talk. I mean, we were connected online,
yeah.
but it wasn't like we were chatting every day. I mean, we probably just met through music. Like I think I started playing out some of your early songs.
Yeah, I had to have been playing
Yeah.
What were you making at first? Or were you making house stuff at first?
At the very first, I was making house stuff, but I feel like probably when you heard of me was when I was just starting to make like kind of trappy stuff. Because I was, at that time, I was super productive. I was putting out like a track every week for a while.
Like, what song do you think? What was your biggest song?
There were a couple. There was one that came out on Fool's Gold called Geeks.
Yeah, Geeks. I play that a lot.
Yeah, yeah. That was the one I think that introduced me to a lot of people. Or maybe I put out records with Trouble and Bass for a while too.
Yeah.
That might be where it was from. Whenever it was, I don't remember where it was. I don't remember the moment. But I do remember just being like, oh, this is like my people. Like when I met you, I was like, oh, this is a cool dude. Like it was one of those instant, I was just like, oh, we're friends now. This is great. Because I don't get that with everybody I meet.
You know? Exactly. Like I was like, oh yeah, we're friends.
All right. So maybe I'll wrap up this way because I've been trying to kind of ask the same question at the end of each of these. Don't think about it too hard. First thing that pops into your mind, what's a memory of yours where a moment in time where music really meant something to you? It could be like something like a show you saw or a song you heard that just had like a really strong effect, whether it was like gave you goosebumps or made you smile or made you tear up or just made you hyped.
Yeah.
Just like a moment.
I definitely have like multiple moments, but
what's the first one that pops into your mind?
Rusko, for sure. Whenever I saw him at a rave in Austin, I saw a bunch of people at this specific rave.
Okay.
I saw Evil Intent. So that was like Gigantor, Bro Safari
and Treasure Fingers.
Right? And also Jake was there.
Kill the Noise.
As, what's his...
The Ludacrist? Is that what they were doing?
Oh, they did Ludacrist. It was so good. Yeah. but no, he did another act before that.
Okay.
E1, right?
Oh, yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, I saw them at the same exact venue. Probably different rave, but yeah, Ludacrist was sick.
Yeah.
That was so amazing. I loved Ludacrist. I always nag Nick about bringing it back.
Yeah, I've talked to Jake about it too.
I love it so much.
It's so good, man.
But anyways, yeah, it was at this rave in Austin at like a rodeo stadium. They converted the main arena into the main stage. So there was house and stuff. And then upstairs in like the owner's box, they had like a table and like speakers, giant speakers and lights. And it was dark. It was a rave.
Yeah.
And Rusko was playing. And I was front row. Holding onto the table,
right,
and my cart pushing ability, since I worked at Walmart and I was a cart pusher, was like holding a big crowd, like pushing back, making sure they didn't like.
You were the barricade.
I was the barricade. Yeah. I was security. No, but it was rough. That moment, just like watching him spin, like, it goosebumps. Like all the songs he was playing.
I mean, when he first came out, man, what a revolution that was.
Yeah.
That was a moment. You know, it's like when Skrillex first came out, or when there's so many people I could name, but I'd never heard something like that before.
Yeah.
And what I love too is you can always, he has so much fun, you can tell he really loves it.
He is the best stage performer ever. It's so amazing how he did. And I think I saw somewhere he went to school for it. He has that stage presence and he's master of it. And it's so awesome. And I was just watching him just like loving the music. And I actually saw him multiple times where he was going off on a great set, but it was like, I would say it was like Dr. P's Sweet Shop whenever he dropped that.
Ooh, yeah.
He opened with it and it was just like such good vibes, and then it dropped and it was like the best drop
ever.
Then
what, did he do a little rewind?
Literally the first song rewound it. It was so sick.
That's such a cool moment.
Yeah,
man.
And I honestly, if people are, if fans are listening, like I want y'all to tell me like what songs make you feel that way like now, because like I'm trying to find that again, and like I'm curious, like what for y'all, like what songs like just give you goosebumps whenever they drop it.
Tweet at us, let us know. I'd be interested too, for anyone who's seen me play over the years, let me know like what are the good tracks. That's a great question for the audience. Let us know, tweet at us, send us a DM, whatever it is, maybe we'll start playing them.
Yeah, I want to try to recreate that energy now for like people now, because it's a new generation now,
right?
That's kind of what I've taken back from like my time off. Like, we have a whole new generation now, and like I gotta think about that. I can't think about the past, like what I've done. It doesn't matter.
Right.
Like, we gotta focus on now, and
yep.
like I want to make that energy now, they're definitely having the same moments that I had whenever I first started going to raves. And, you know, I'm super curious. Like, what's that like? Like, yeah. I got to get back because I'm overstimulated right now.
Yeah, 100%. And you want to get back to, you know, how you felt the first time, right?
Yeah, it's like what I want we were just. So
yeah, that's what I want. That's all I want is like, you know, to go back because I have those goosebumps moments too that I'll remember for the rest of my life.
Last night, someone came up after the show and they're like, this is my first concert ever. Can you sign this? Like, this is so cool. Yeah, it's like, damn, that's kind of crazy to think about. Like, I can't think about it all the time because I'm not living.
Right.
I didn't just, like, start going to shows.
Well, you know? Maybe that kid will have a moment from the show last night where you played some song that, you know, exactly. Made him go crazy. Yeah. At the end of the day, I mean, I think that's why I keep coming back to it is that connection with people that we were talking about earlier. Like, when you play the song that everybody wants to hear at the right time, I mean, that's just a magical moment. That's like probably what doing a lot of drugs feels like.
I think you've never done drugs?
No, I've done a few. I've dabbled, but like I'm not a drug guy.
Yeah,
and I would never say I've done a lot of drugs.
Yeah, exactly.
To get back to my original point, like that feeling is what I imagine it must feel like to just be that high.
It's got
to
be, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And it's, you know, those moments, that's what I chase. I mean, I think I am addicted to it in a certain extent that like I'm just always trying to get back to that feeling and mm-hmm. that vibe. And I'm addicted, not in a bad way.
Yeah, but Sonny talks about it all the time. Like, you know, the kids are pushing the music. That's what it's all about. Because they have that feeling now.
Yeah.
And like, that's what they're going to remember for the rest of their lives. So you have to like almost cater to them and make sure, you know, like they experience it the right way.
Sure, yeah. And, yeah, there is a responsibility there. Yeah.
And it's fun to just like, you know, pick their brain because they're the next generation.
Yeah, they're setting the tone. I mean, we're just along for their ride at this point. You know what I mean?
I mean, they still like look up to us and it's crazy to think about. And
right.
Like a lot of people still think I'm a kid. Like, I mean, I still get asked like if I'm old enough to sit in the exit row. But that's maybe because I just look young.
Yeah, I think that's probably it, man. One, and doing this, I talked about this with Diplo on the show. I mean, it keeps us young, right?
Exactly.
Like, yeah.
I want to be like Diplo. I want to be able to do it this long. Because like people ask me that all the time. Like, how long are you going to be doing this, you know, like for the rest of your life? And I'm like, yeah, why not?
Well, that feels like a pretty good place to wrap it up. Super positive. Thanks for doing this with me, man. I'm glad we finally linked up to do it because you really are one of my favorite people to talk to.
Yeah. And you are as well. Like I love the conversations we have. I can't have with a lot of people because, you know, they can't ask the right questions, I guess. And it sucks because like you want to have a great conversation with everyone. Right. I think, yeah, you're definitely one of my favorite people to talk to actually.
Oh, man. I appreciate that.
We get so many ideas across and like, it's hard to get those random ideas that I have in my head all the time. I don't get to talk to a lot of people about it. But yeah, there's something about this podcast that you can ask those questions and you know personally what it's like being a DJ. And it's awesome. I love the podcast.
Oh, thank you, man. Well, I love you.
Love you too, man.
All right, that's the show. I want to thank Crizzly so much for coming through, staying a couple nights at my place. It was a pleasure kicking it with you, man. Don't forget to go check out Crizzly's new Crunkstep Volume 4 mix up on his SoundCloud right now. The link is going to be in the description of this show. My name is Willy Joy. You can follow me on all social media at Willy Joy. I want to hear from you guys. You can also email me questions, comments, concerns, backtobackpod@gmail.com is that address. Email me some questions I can read on the air. Let's keep this rolling, guys. 20 episodes deep, feeling great. I'm going to see you next week. Have a good one. Peace.